Good morning and welcome to St. John's. It's a wonderful day to be in the house of the Lord. Today we celebrate Unity Sunday, and we will have Father Grant Wiseman with us, and Dr. Tim is across the way at First Baptist. So let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship.
Thank you.
seated as we pray together the opening prayer found in your bulletin. Let us pray. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Welcome again to St. John's this morning. We have a few announcements. I would like to invite you to stay for lunch today. If you have not noticed, there are all varieties of soup and salad sponsored by the Friendship Sunday School class, and they invite you to stay to have a bowl of soup here or to take some home. So, and all your donations will go to their mission projects. So do plan to stay for that. I remind the men that the men's Bible study with Dr. Tim continues on Tuesday evenings at 6:30 in the Faith Center. So come out for that. If you have not done so already, the friendship pads are located near the center aisle. Take time to put your name down, and if you have new cell phones or new home numbers or email addresses, or if you are new to St. John's, please share some contact information so that we may reach out to you this week. At this time, I'd like to invite Renee Reed to come up, who will share a mission minute with us.
Good morning, St. John's. As the chair of your mission leadership team, I am blessed to have this opportunity to share with you this morning. Last weekend, this church came together with our local mission partners for our Saturday of Service project and our Mission Impact Celebration Sunday. It was a prayer of your mission leadership team that God would show up in a mighty way and that our congregation would show up like never before. Well, we thank you because you did just that. On Saturday of Service, our church helped 10 local organizations through donation of items or by actual service. The amount of items that we collected during the month of January was truly phenomenal. We asked for donations of toiletry items for Grace Kitchen. You gave so many toiletry items that we bless those we serve at Grace Kitchen, those that are homebound that receive a Grace Kitchen breakfast. And then there was extra. We gave toiletry items to Life Choices, Helping Hands, Christ Central, and saved some for an upcoming trip to Honduras. And that was just the toiletry items. You also gave generously with items for Acts, Helping Hands, and Life Choices. On Saturday of service, our church members came together and sorted these items and then delivered them to our local mission partners. And then you went to work. At Acts, our church stocked shelves. At Helping Hands, our church organized the clothing closet. At Life Choices, you took a tour and learned about ways that you could volunteer in the future. Our church raked leaves, pulled weeds, and mowed grass at Stand at the Crossroad Ministries. You organized a storage shed for Sockahatchee, and you built a wheelchair ramp for someone in need. At the Habitat store, our church swept, cleaned, dusted, and washed windows. They said the store hadn't looked that good since it opened. Some of you worked with Joseph's Coat to make items for cancer patients. The children of our church saved coins the whole month of January and brought baby items for Life Choices. Some children pitched in and did yard work, and some helped build a wheelchair ramp. The previous Saturday, the youth of our church went to Christ Central's weekly kids club. They sang with the boys and girls who come there every week, and our youth provided fellowship and lunch. Saturday of service was truly an amazing day. Then in preparation for our MIC Sunday, our church cooked on Friday, set up tables and chairs on Saturday, decorated and set the tables, helped serve the food, and put up the chairs after lunch on Sunday. We thank each and every one of you because you all came together in support of this celebration of missions and our local mission partners. Thank you. And none of this is possible without the commitment of our church. You are a generous church with your donations, your prayers, and your financial giving. Our mission partners are able to accomplish much. Not only do they provide for people's physical needs, but they give Jesus to each and every person who walks in their door. There is much in this world that needs to be addressed, but as Christians, as the church, we are responsible to make disciples and to spread the good news of Jesus' great love. So last Sunday, we had the opportunity to turn in our faith promise pledges. These pledges go above and beyond our regular commitment to the church operational budget. 1 year ago, your faith promise pledges totaled $171,000. And I'm happy to announce that throughout this past year, you gave $172,634. Thank you. I think it's important for you to know that your faith promise donations go 100% to missions. Since last Sunday, our faith promise pledges for this year are $165,179. Your mission leadership team makes our annual budget based upon these pledges. So if you were not able to attend last Sunday or haven't had the chance to turn in a pledge card, I hope you will. This is an ongoing effort, so please take the time to consider how the Lord is leading you to support our church mission partners. Anytime God provides, we hope you will consider making a faith promise offering. There is one last piece of exciting news that I want to share with you. Plans have begun for a church-wide mission trip for the summer of 2019. If God has planted a seed in your heart to go, then this is the time to act. We will begin forming this team very soon, and the reason for this is so the team will have time to get to know each other, to pray together, to learn about the culture they'll be visiting, and also so they can fundraise together. I know if God wants you to go on this trip, He will provide. So look for the coming announcement and meeting times. It is our hope that every person in this church will support this trip in some way, and it will truly be a church-wide mission trip. St. John's, thank you for your heart for missions and your heart for Jesus. That combination is what brought you together for Saturday of service, and is what will keep us serving our mission partners going forward. Thank you.
Thank you.
stand as you are able as we affirm our faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Seated as we pray together. Dear gracious and loving God, we gather as your children in this place for this worship time. May we be transformed even a little by your word, by Father Wiseman's message, by the hymns and songs we have sung and will sing and hear today. Let us remember how Jesus came to serve others. Let us respond to that call on our lives to serve others. We are who we are because of you, Lord. Use us today and in the weeks ahead for your good. Let us be shining beacons in a world filled with hate and violence. Use us to bring others to know you as Lord and Savior. We hold close this morning our family and friends who are dealing with difficulties. We pray that you give them your peace, touch them with your healing hand, lift them up, give them strength. Bless each one. Now together we pray the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. God has blessed each one of us in so many ways. I invite our ushers to come forward to receive God's tithes and his offerings.
Healer of our every ill, light of each joy be. comfort fill our hearts. Healer of our every ill, light of each tomorrow, give us peace beyond our fear and hope beyond our sorrow. In the pain and joy beholding how your grace is still unfolding, give us all your vision, God of love. Healer of our every ill, light of each joy beyond our sorrow. You know each thought and feeling. Teach us all your way of healing. Spirit of compassion, fill our heart. Healer of our every ill, light of each tomorrow, peace beyond our fear and joy beyond our sorrow. Give us peace beyond our fear and joy
Please remain standing as we sing our hymn of preparation, number 452, My Faith Looks Up to Thee, and our crucifer will lead our children to Children's Church, which is located in the chapel.
Thank you.
Please remain standing for the hearing of the gospel from Mark chapter 1, verses 29 through 39. As soon as they left the synagogue, they entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they told him about her at once. He came and took her by the hand and lifted her up. Then the fever left her, and she began to serve them. That evening at sunset, they brought to him all who were sick or possessed with demons, and the whole city was gathered around the door. And he cured many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons. And he would not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. In the morning, while it was still very dark, he got up and went out to a deserted place, and there he prayed. And Simon and his companions hunted for him. When they found him, they said to him, "Everyone is searching for you." He answered, "Let us go on to the neighboring town so that I may proclaim the message there also, for that is what I came out to do." And he went throughout Galilee, proclaiming the message in their synagogues and casting out demons. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Be seated. It's my pleasure this morning to introduce Father Grant Wiseman, who is the rector at St. Thaddeus, just down the street. He is not new to us, and we are glad to have him here today. Welcome, Father Grant.
It's very good to be with you this morning. As was said, I am Grant Wiseman and the rector of St. Thaddeus. I tend to move around a lot, so just I'm going to warn you of that right away. The pulpit is a little confining for somebody with ADHD. I am the father of twins. I have twin 18-year-old daughters. They're about to graduate from Mead Hall, and my wife and I were talking about this over the past few years, and I turned to about a year and a half to her and said to her, "You know, I don't think we're done yet." And she said, "I am. I had twins once, I'm not doing that again." But over a little bit of time, we started talking and we realized, yes, we weren't completely done wanting to have children be a part of our lives. And as our daughters are headed off to Berry College and to Wofford, we started realizing that we wanted to have children as a part of our lives some more. So we began the process about foster care. Now, for those of you who don't know this, there are at least 1,200 kids whose parental rights have been permanently terminated in the state of South Carolina. There are anywhere between 3,500 and 5,500 kids in foster care on any given day. Think about those numbers. That's pretty huge. The reality is there are kids that need homes and need families. And as I understand it, your organist has also been involved in foster care and has two children as well. Well, what happened for Heather and me is we were hoping to adopt and from one of the permanently terminated kids. Well, it's really odd, but the process is really long. It takes all sorts of work to try to get the kids, and not every kid's a good match and all of those things. And we were getting a little anxious. And so all of a sudden we got a phone call, and normally the process is you go, when you're doing the foster to adopt, where we're actually taking up kids whose parental rights have been terminated, you meet them at like a McDonald's. Then you get to spend a little bit of time with them the next weekend, and then a little bit of time over. And then you say, yeah, this is the kid I want in my house, or these are the children I want in my house. Very different from foster care. Emergency foster care, they call you, and they could be there within minutes. Well, they called us on a Monday and said, "We have two kids that need to be emergency placed. They are kids that whose parental rights are scheduled to be terminated. They've just not had the termination of parental rights hearing. Would you be willing to take these two kids in? It's a boy and a girl." Now, we had originally thought if we were going to have two, we'd want two of the same. And in our house, I'm well experienced with girls. In fact, our first 6 years of marriage, my wife and I lived in a boarding school, and we had 87 teenage girls living in our house with us. I know girls. Well, they called us and they asked, would you be able to do it? And 2 days later, after having to do a few extra things to make it all work out, two kids come running out of this minivan up our driveway and jumped into our arms, calling us mommy and daddy right away. Now, I will tell you, there is nothing like the hug of a small child and knowing, and when they come in and you just want to hold them and love them, it's just this most amazing thing. And I tell you this story because I think it's important for us to recognize that I believe God has called us to welcome with open arms all those in need, all those people that need our love and need Christ's love, and to recognize that we are called as Christians to be that open, to be that willing to respond to God's call to us. Now, that when these children arrived, it's been a challenge. I will tell you, I'm 51 years old. Last time I had a four-year-old in my house, I was 35. My little sister is a grandmother. So keeping up with my little boy has been a challenge. Boys do things differently than girls. Any of you folks who are parents of only one or the other, boy or girl, you've not lived until you have both of them in some ways. Because each of them do different things that you just never, you look and go, really? What were you thinking? And yet I realized that part of that was what we were called to do. We were called to be open to that possibility. Jesus in his gospel today talks about him being and preaching and being a part of people's lives, healing them, walking among them. He goes into Simon's mother's house. She's not feeling well. So he makes her feel better, and then she immediately goes and serves them, which is kind of an interesting thing to me. Why is it that he heals her and she's the one getting then serving? But we'll drop that for a little while. But just in a couple hours later, the whole of the town want to come and be healed, and demons are removed, and all of those other things happen. And Jesus then the next morning gets up early and goes out to pray. And while he's out there, Simon and his buddies come up and say, hey, the whole town wants you to come back. They want you right back there. And what I realized in reading that, because then Jesus says, no, I'm called to go and proclaim this beyond just here. I need to go out and spread this word to everyone. Well, that's kind of in some ways the way we are as church. We go to the church that we feel most comfortable in, sit in the same pew with the same people every Sunday. And that's okay. Because there are lots of other churches for all sorts of other people. But one of the things that doesn't let us do sometimes is recognize the breadth and the width of our faith, those people who are so much more different than we. I invite you sometime to go to one of those other churches and check them out. I will tell you that when I first started these pulpit swaps, one of my first trips was to Second Baptist. Now, I will tell you, every time I said something funny or good, I heard an amen. So where is it, folks? This is much more like my church on Sunday. But what I'm saying is that they worship in a wonderful and exciting way, and you get to feel the Spirit. And part of the reason we come here on Sunday, every Sunday, is to be filled with the Holy Spirit, to be recharged, to have our batteries overflowing so that we can go and do the things that God has called us to do and be the rest of the week. Now, society would much rather you just come here for an hour every week and get your Jesus on and then take him off and go outside and be back to what society would have you be. But I'm here to tell you, that's not why we're here. We're here because God has called us to be ready, to be prepared, to go and do the things that he would have us do. Be open to the possibility that my ministry to whomever I meet will change their lives, will give them that same kind of power and spirit that you feel when you're fully engaged with God. Feeling that incredible love. Now, I can tell you it's not always easy. Because when we open up the table, it's uncomfortable. I mean, it's easy for us to be comfortable with everybody we know at the table. You know, we may have some crazy people in our family on Thanksgiving, but we know them already. Now, I will tell you that one of the greatest things Aiken does is it's one table. How many of you have been to one table? I will tell you, I like one table for what it does, and I think everybody should go at least once or twice, or once every few years. Now, my problem is I tend to try to go the same year I'm blessing the hounds. So by the time I get there, all of the green bean casserole is gone. But there is something wonderful about sitting at table with a bunch of people many of which you don't know, and sitting next to people you wouldn't normally sit next to, and talking to them, and getting to know them, and getting to share that meal, to be a place that's open enough and big enough that all are welcome. That's one of the things that I know Christ says to us. All are meant to be welcome in our church. Not just the people who sin like we do, but the people who sin in ways that are uncomfortable for us. Because guess what? Some of our sins are uncomfortable to them. So we need to be that big, wide church that's so open that God can't help but be shining forth. Now, I'll tell you, it's hard because each and every one of us are called at a certain time and a certain place to be that person, to be that minister. Each and every one of us have times in our lives where we are the one that God is calling to do something. And sometimes we listen. More often than not, we sort of cruise on by and then realize it as we're passed. Now, I'll tell you a story about myself because it illustrates what I'm going to say. I am the former chairman of the Standing Commission on Stewardship and Development for the Episcopal Church, which basically means people think I can raise money. But actually, it's bigger than that. The reason I was a part of it was mainly because it talked about not just raising money, but our response to Jesus. Once we say, I believe, it's all that I am and all that I have once I say, I believe. Now, that doesn't mean that you need to walk out and give your whole salary to St. John's Methodist Church so that the ministry can happen. But what it does mean, though, is it should be a reflection of what you do, of who you are and your faith in God. It should be something where each and every part of your day is prayer. Each and every part of your day is a response to the wonderful love that God has given us. Now, I was in the Walmart on Richland Avenue. How many have been in the Walmart on Richland Avenue? How many have waited in line in the Walmart at Richland Avenue? I always pick the wrong line. Mine is always a little bit, seems always to get a little, it looks short when I get there. Well, this one day, early day in Lent a few years ago, I was about ready to head to go and give a talk to a church in Camden about stewardship and development and all of the things that they could possibly do with all the gifts that God had given them. And I stopped at the Walmart to get something, and I'm waiting in line. And while I'm waiting in line, I'm listening to the conversation in front of me. It's this young couple. And this young couple, you could just tell they were kind of excited but a little nervous. They were talking about their new house. Well, as the line was going, I could hear them continue to talk, and they were talking about all the things they needed, and I realized it was not so much a house like I think of a house. It was more of a trailer. And as the line went a little further, it seemed like it was a trailer that in need of a lot of work. And then they began to argue over whether or not they could afford a toilet seat. And I was listening to them, and I was thinking, well, I'm the rector of St. Thaddeus Episcopal Church. I have a really good discretionary fund. I could take care of their whole bill. I could certainly take care of that toilet seat. I should do something. And I started thinking about it. I should do it. I should do it. I should do it. I should do it. They checked out. I checked out. I got in my car, and I started driving to Camden. And about 5 minutes into that drive, I looked at myself in the mirror, and I said, boy, Grant, you surely didn't respond when something was put right in front of you. You didn't. You were the one who was most equipped to help those people right then and there. Why didn't you do something? Why? And so I vowed that Lent to really be aware, more aware of those things in front of me when they happened, those opportunities to minister. Because when you have, when you take those opportunities to minister and run with them, they not only feed you, but they feed others in such incredible ways that you have no idea how that feeling is and how wonderful it is for them. Now, I'll tell you, I spent the rest of that Lent in Walmart looking for somebody to buy a toilet seat for. Because it became a visual thing for me that I needed to be willing to look and listen and try to find the needs of those people, of all the people around us. Now we do a lot of, our family does a lot of things about taking care of others. We foster puppies. We've had over 700 puppies at our house. It's Puppy Central. And one of the things that in doing that, one of the things we recognize is that unconditional love that dogs give us. How many people understand that? Yes. Well, I believe God's called us to give that unconditional love to others in the same way. We need to look at people as if they are in desperate need of Christ's love and our love. In the Episcopal Church, at the early service, the 7:45, we use Rite One, which is old Elizabethan language. And right after that first prayer, like the one you said at the beginning, the prayer we said at the beginning, Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Right? We all said that. The next thing we say right after that is, it's going into Elizabethan language, it's almost like I'm going to be speaking Shakespeare. Love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Now, when I hear that, I hear some amazing things. I hear, one, that God loves me, and that I should love one another as God, as Christ loves me. Now, that's harder. Because there are some people I don't want to love. And yet I know I'm called to do it. I'm called to go out of my way to do it. To look at the other in a way that is so much bigger and broader than what I would define myself. To go out and really be that saving embrace. Be that open table. That place where everyone's invited. Where everyone knows the love of God and has the opportunity, because of what we do when we leave this church with our batteries refreshed, to do the ministry that we're called to do each and every day. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind, and love your neighbors as yourself. Amen.
Please stand as we sing our hymn of dedication, number 102. Now thank we all our God.
May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you this day and remain with you always. Amen.